Thank you very much. I'm going to talk about physical intelligence. Physical intelligence, you might wonder what does that mean? I actually don't know what that exactly means. I had actually a hard time finding the right word to describe this. Hopefully after my talk, you might have a little bit better understanding what I'm trying to say. I hope I understand a little bit what I'm trying to say. Speaking of superpower, I actually think being able to move my hand, my tongue every day, I think this is just amazing. I'm not sure if I call that a superpower because everyone else can do this, but as a roboticist, I'm amazed by how we can move my body as easily as we do every day. So let me talk about the physical intelligence. Before talking about that, we are such a consumed, our life is so consumed by this technology. I asked my students, how many hours do you spend on your cell phone? And then the average student was like 6 hours. If you think about it, like you have 24 hours, sleeping in 8 hours, and then leftover, you have 6 hours, a pretty big chunk of time. And as amazing this technology move on, as a roboticist, I'm more interested in something like physical services, which is quite different from what you can see, what you can do with your cell phone. Cell phone can do information service really well. We can deliver information as effectively possible, as quick as possible, as easy as possible. But things you can do in the physical service is very different. For example, home security. You have something, some agent need to move around and then do some action. And smart factory, there are a lot of factories that start moving to a different direction. Farming, all these things you really need to have some physical action. You can't really just sending an algorithm or sending bits in, through the network to solve the problem. I'm particularly interested in elderly care. This is something rising in our radar. If you look at countries like Korea or Japan or Northern Europe, the demographic shape looking really scary in the future. For example, in 2050, in Korea and Japan, above 65 will be more than 40% of the entire population. So I'm getting really, really interested in providing better physical service, hopefully with our robot. So let's take a look at the robot that actually providing us really good physical services. So most of them are actually currently in the factory. We developed this technology for the last 60 years so that we can actually buy a car in a much cheaper price. These robots are amazing. They can move much faster than us, much more accurate, much more reliable, and never get tired. These robots can run 24 hours. If you look at really carefully, though, if you've ever been in a factory, these robots actually never touch objects like a human. So when it comes to soft object, think about like putting even a simple task like this electric harness plugging in. Robots still cannot do this. Just imagine like putting a leather seat on the sponge. Like the tasks that require a lot of dexterity, robots are still can do this. So still you'll see a lot of people in the factory dealing with this like contact-rich tasks. Because these robots are actually not designed to do this. These robots are designed to do very rigid, precise motion tracking. Just go here, XYZ, move here, XYZ. They're not designed to interact, heavily interact with the environment. So about 10 years or so, while I was at MIT, I've been focusing on the idea of how can I change our robot design paradigm from this factory setting to more realistic. In the factory setting, your robot already know what to do and everything position is known. Go here, weld here, go here, weld here, and weld here, and come back. There's no intelligence. These robots are just repeating same task over and over again. Whereas some situation like a disaster response, nothing is really known. Robot has to be much more adaptive. Robot cannot be bolted down to the ground like a manufacturing robot. You have to balance. You have to control the force. All that, you have to really think about how to design differently. So I will show you some very quick summary of what I've been working on and all the robots in development in our lab. These are, we call the MIT Cheetahs. There are many different versions. You can always see the difference between older robot and version, new versions. You can see some evolution of design. This is actually the fastest robot we ever built. It runs 60 meters per second, and then you can run outdoors. But this robot only can run only forward. But it has a pretty cool technology. It has a LiDAR sensor. It can detect the obstacle and jump over obstacle like a horse. And we evolved toward a little bit more realistic and practical application. Running really fast robot is very dangerous. So we start thinking about, oh, can we build a robot can do something more diverse, turn better or jump off the table, for example. And this is the latest robot we built in the quadrupedal family, and it's called a Mini Cheetah. It got a lot smaller, so we can do experiments so much more easily. So it's about half size. This is the one of our most advanced balance algorithm. It can turn, this is real time, it can actually turn really, really fast without falling. And it can have a much better elegant gait because we have a much better control algorithm. And we eventually built 10 of them in the lab. These are all built by our graduate students. And we also add cameras, and then you can adjust our steps based on your obstacles, and then obstacles too big, you can also jump over. So these robots are only possible by our new technology that allows to handle impact. Very different from manufacturing robot that only can do X, Y, Z. These robots actually can handle impact from falling, can jump over obstacle. So now we're moving on to the actually bipedal robot. So this robot is right sitting in our lab at this point, and then we're investigating how can we build the control algorithm as good as we saw in the previous slide, those quadrupedal robots. And we're still debating, like, how can we mix these two technologies between the data-driven, you're probably familiar with a lot of AI technologies, machine learning, versus model predictive control, which we've been working on the last 10 years. This is more conventional technology using Newton's mechanics, following our intuition, using our mass, and applying right forces. And there are pros and cons between these two technologies. We're actually really working hard to fuse this to really realize a human-like bipedal locomotion. So locomotion is one thing, but in order to build, provide a really physical service, moving around is not only is not enough. You have to actually use your arm to actually provide the real manipulation task. So we initially thinking about, can we build some like the best teleoperation system? This is the best teleoperation system we ever seen, and then realized in our lab, my hand actually can feel the forces from the other hand, and the other hand basically follow exactly what my hand is doing. These are all done in very high frequency control algorithm. Yet we soon realized, even the hardware is really good, and then really copy what my hand is doing, this kind of teleoperation is not going to be very scalable, especially if you are trying to provide service far away. This is connected with wire, but if you control a robot through internet, all these high fidelity feedback is not going to be possible. That's a fundamental limit. So we start looking at some more autonomous behavior with the very rich sensors. So the first sensor, this is something we developed for over 10 years. And combined with our very specialized hardware, you can actually perform something very extraordinary. So this sensor not only detects contact force and also contact location at the same time with the very high frequency, so we can virtually make your wood and then rubber attract to each other. This is all through the control algorithm. So we're trying to develop this kind of lower level, very like a physical contact related stuff using build a component of the technology so we can apply this robot in the real world without worrying about all these very complex behaviors. We call that as a last centimeter problem. As you can see in the manufacturing robot, you can actually control robot really well approaching it. All the detailed challenges happening actually last centimeter. How are we gonna collide with the object, what the object tumble, what are we gonna do? So all these things has to be handled by this like a rich sensor feedback. I can show you another very sensor-driven research. There's something the proximity sensor can actually detect the obstacle without even touching it. So robot can automatically wrap around the object, and then if you think it's a good shape, now you can apply force. Now you can apply the feedback from this contact sensor. You can grasp object and manipulate object much, much better. But yeah, if you really compare with your hand, as I said in the beginning, I'm always amazed by how well I can control my hand. So I actually don't know. So I took a video of my hand and grabbing fruits, in this case, pear. And a lot of times, it was nothing interesting happened. But once in a while, this thing happened. By the way, I'm not looking at the apple. I'm not looking at the pear. I'm just looking somewhere else and then grabbing this fruit. And I hope you can see what's going on. I will show you in the real time first. That was about 0.7 second. If you watch in slow motion, lots of things happen. It collided with the pears, and then it failed to grasp. And while failing, it ended up touching my hand, ended up touching five different pears, and then identify the best the fruit to have grasp. I don't think that's actually the best option, but somehow my hand decided to choose the worst possible choice. My hand is much dumber than I expected. If I write a control algorithm, I wouldn't pick that pair. Somehow my hand is going to the bottom one. But what's really amazing is all this decision making happened. If you watch that again, there's like five, six different decision making. That happens about 0.7 seconds. Do I remember any of that? I have a completely oblivious about it. Right now, I want you to grab something, take out something from your pocket. Try it right now. Probably won't take too much time. I can just count like one, two, three, four, five. Everybody do it. Does anyone remember what your index finger was doing? Or even your thumb? Do you remember commanding, oh, the second joint trajectory should be this shape so I can... Do you remember any of those? These are completely oblivious for us. It's very autonomous. We are living daily life using your hand almost every minute. We are completely oblivious. If you want to really start to think about it, I want you to think about your tongue. Everybody ate something during lunch? Have you ever thought about the eating process? You chop up a foot using your teeth. You might be aware of that. You might remember that. But after that, somehow it magically goes into your stomach. Oh, my teeth are chewing. But your teeth have a multiple degree of freedom? No, your teeth are basically two pieces of rock, right? Something in the middle grab those food and then push to the teeth and then put, like, the teeth chop down to small pieces. And somehow you choose a size of the object. Oh, it's too big, I'll put it back. Small enough, I'll throw it in the back of the throat. If you found a piece of paper, oh, no, I don't want to eat this, and bring it out to your lips so you can take it out while you're talking with your friend. What do you use when you talk? Tongue, right? So tongue was doing all these things. Have any of you thought about this or remember what your tongue was doing through lunch? These are all automatic. These are amazing tasks, amazing physical feat. But we don't remember. We don't even, our brain is completely oblivious. These are all happening in subconscious level. So I want you to think about what is really intelligent. We call chess player, oh, the best chess player in the world, or just best Go player, or somebody like a professor writing like equation like with very complex concept. That's called, we call it intelligent, right? But we never call somebody grabbing complex object from your pocket. That's not intelligent behavior. My son can do it. My two-year-old can do this. We never call that intelligent. Maybe that's okay for us. I don't think that's true in robotics, at least. There are robots that can beat us in chess very easily, almost everyone. The best player in the world, we can beat it. There's not a single robot can clean the dishes like we do. I can guarantee you, there's not a single robot bring a key out of my pocket and can do it. Doesn't have that capability, doesn't have that intelligence. We have a very biased a point of view when we judge what are the intelligent behavior, what is not intelligent behavior. Because these are so easy for us. We are evolved to do this. We've been evolved, human evolved through millions of years, hundreds of millions of years, to be able to run, to be able to eat, to be able to use a hand, because those are essential for life. How essential to be able to write an equation and play chess or Go for our survival? These have been only a few hundred years for human history. So I want you to really think about what are the technologies going to change our life in the future, especially application like this. In the future, our elderly population is going to explode. We're not going to have enough labor to support them. And look at how much contact and physical help is required. She's not even paralyzed. She's just weak in the muscle. And then she's just barely trying to move from bed to the wheelchair, which is obviously the biggest challenge of the people who use a wheelchair user. Wheelchair user moving from bed to the wheelchair, wheelchair to the ground is the biggest challenge. And think about what kind of technology is going to really change our life. I think physical intelligence is something we have to really focus on, and then we have to really work for it. Thank you very much.